Thank you very much, Misha. Thanks to the Einstein Forum for again hosting a very interesting event, very inspiring topic as always. Yeah, it's my great pleasure and honor to be the chair of our event tonight. We have 1.5 hours together. We will proceed as follows after I have introduced Professor Ching Kwan Lee. And she will give a talk, obviously, a presentation. We then will for sure have still plenty of time left for your questions. And we would kindly ask you to put your questions, and you can do this during the talk whenever you feel inspired to note something down in the Q&A forum, which is called FNA, I believe, Frage und Antworten in German, or Q&A, depending probably, of course, on the language of your Zoom. So please do put the questions in there, if you cannot in the chat, because then we can more conveniently kind of read them out, which I will do, and also try to, if necessary, bundle them together. So feel free to ask questions. We very much looking forward and to engage with all of you to the discussion. And yeah, it's my privilege indeed, and honor and great joy to introduce our speaker tonight, who is with us from Los Angeles, California. She was supposed to come actually to Europe, to Potsdam, for the originally planned offline event. But as we all know, we have to be flexible and resilient, and have all also in the audience, I guess, great training in being adaptable to changes due to the ongoing pandemic. But yeah, we have a great setup here with Zoom. It's great to be still able to connect. And yeah, Professor Ching Kwan Lee is a professor of sociology at the University of California in Los Angeles since 2008. Actually, and she has been called by multiple scholars and journalists and analysts one of the sharpest researchers of labor and social movements in China and Hong Kong. She not only researches and teaches on China and Hong Kong, but she teaches on work in general, on globalization, on political sociology, development of the global South, comparative ethnography, and also Africa. So she's really looking at China also tonight from a comparative and a global perspective. And this actually really shows in her rich biography, this global and comparative perspective. She is deeply rooted in sociology. She studied first in Hong Kong, did her BA there in 1988, also very interesting, obviously, times with 89 just building up and just being around the corner, basically. She then continued her studies in the US at UC Berkeley, first an MA and then her PhD also in the mid 90s. She then went back to Hong Kong for 5 years to teach and research at the Chinese University of Hong Kong, her alma mater, so to say. And then again, she returned or went back. I mean, it's probably, yeah, depending on where you stand from, transition, probably, I would say, again to the US in 2000. And she was there, an associate professor for sociology at the University of Michigan. She also has been a fellow at all of the, you know, renowned universities in the US, Princeton, Stanford, Harvard, also at the Woodrow Wilson Center for Scholars in Washington. And she is deeply rooted and committed to ethnographic fieldwork, especially in China. And she also teaches a class on it. Talking about being in the field, she's also a scholar, Professor Lee, who has really put skin in the game, so to say. She has never been an activist. She shared that herself, but she has been a scholar who courageously and continuously really took a stance for what she believes is also the basis of scholarship, right? Freedom and pluralism, and multiple perspectives, and to voice your opinion freely. And she got attacked actually multiple times, especially in the last 2 years of being, you know, violating potentially the national security law, So she really also got under pressure for her academic work, basically. And this, of course, although it's not our topic tonight, tells us how much Hong Kong has, the situation there has deteriorated, and how dangerous it is for scholars to do research there. Professor Lee has published multiple articles and volumes, three of them, and you find more information on the website. That's why I'm also, for the sake of time, not repeating those information. But yeah, three really interesting and inspiring monographs on China and the whole issue of the labor movement, the gender perspective, and also how that relates to the global perspective. Her first, the most recent one was covering Africa, China's footprint over there. And yeah, she won multiple prizes for that. Also, one is available in German, by the way, for all German speakers or readers, published in 2010, Aufbruch der zweiten Generation, Wanderarbeiter, Gender und Klassenzusammen. Halt in China. Her two latest edited volumes also go beyond the scope of our topic tonight, but also very worth reading. We got them to our library just lately. Take Back Our Future, an Eventful Sociology of the Hong Kong Umbrella Movement, a very insightful on the ground, theoretically though, but also very empirical account of the umbrella movement in 2014, and then a recent edited volume about the social question in the 21st century, a global view, which really covers cases from Latin America, Middle East, Africa, Central Europe. So Professor Lee really collaborated again with other sociologist and bringing in her, as I said, very rich empirical, theoretical, analytical perspective on China. And Professor Lee, with that, I would like to hand it over to you. The topic of tonight is called How China Rides the Wave of Crisis, Going Digital and Going Global. And we're very much looking forward to your presentation. Thank you, Professor Lee.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Kristen. So let me share my screen. So, well, good evening, good afternoon, good morning, everyone, wherever you are. I'm very pleased to be part of the Einstein Forum, which, according to the website, is a laboratory of the mind. I really like that description. Today, I would discuss two broad elite strategies in China since around the year 2008, the time when the world was affected by the financial meltdown in the US. These two strategies have since shaped Chinese development, both within its border as well as in the world. But I think more generally, I hope to push back against the idea that China is exceptional. These days, you actually hear a lot of this argument that China is exceptional, both from the Chinese side, saying that China is exceptional in a good way. So for instance, since 2008, the government and the party has always argued that China was less exposed to the 2008 financial crisis, and therefore the Chinese system is superior. But I would like to show that the truth is 2008 was a truly global crisis, and the fallout of 2008 occasioned a very important, a sharp restructuring within China that exacerbates some of these problems. And then in the West, both the politicians and pundits would also argue, promote this idea that China is exceptional, but in a bad way. So we hear often that China is uniquely and extremely repressive and aggressive. And many people point the problem, the culprit, to Xi Jinping, the president himself, his personal political ambition are driving these aggression and repression. But what I like to show today is that we should see beyond a personal, one single individual autocrat, and to see some of the underlying political economic challenges that China is facing and therefore reacting to with repression and aggression. So let me go to my presentation, and we'll have, I hope we'll have plenty of time for discussion. Okay, so let's start with 2008, the financial crisis and its aftermath. Despite what China said, this period, this moment in our recent history occasioned two crises in China. Now, crises, the term sounds very dramatic, and we don't hear the Chinese government using this term. You hear more often challenges, and it's kind of subjective what constitutes a crisis, at what point it becomes a challenge, or a challenge becomes a crisis. But I think analytically, we can say there are two crises that were triggered by 2008, the meltdown in the West, in China. The first is accumulation, or what Marxists would call accumulation crisis, in the sense that the financial crisis meant or immediately led to an exhaustion of export-led high growth model in China, because the West was not buying as much. There was a shrinkage in the export market. Signal to China, compelled China to look for another model of growth that it has relied on, which was export in the past 30 years. So that constituted a crisis. And the immediate impact of that at that time, I still remember, I was researching, was doing field work on China's labor market as well at that time. And immediately within 3 months after 2008, the fall of 2008, 20 million people lost a job, and the government asked them to return to the countryside. So that was massive unemployment. And in response to that, the Chinese government, in response to the 2008 crisis, the Chinese government actually put out a stimulus package that was as big as the US stimulus package. And that exacerbated a systemic problem that it had for a long time. And that systemic problem was overaccumulation. Too many local governments and enterprises compete with each other to produce the same thing, because their career was dependent on registering or obtaining growth rate, regardless of profit margin. And so everybody is competing to produce more and more because of the political incentive system. And this has already, before 2008, generated redundant productive capacity in so many different items, but most saliently in steel, cement, all these construction material. This systemic overaccumulation problem was exacerbated by the stimulus package that came after 2008. There's more money. Government and companies went in debt to finance further expansion of productive capacity. Now, this created a crisis because profit margin necessarily fell, because you produce more than you could consume. And that is why, you know, we see later on a major response was to go global. But that's the accumulation crisis. The other kinds of crisis that was triggered by the financial crisis, and that is related to accumulation crisis, is what, again, Marxists would call legitimation crisis. Anytime the Chinese economy suffers any setback, it easily becomes a political issue, because the Communist Party has buttressed its legitimation in the past 30 years on delivering growth. And so if there is slow growth or no growth, it hurt its legitimacy. So this is the reason why financial crisis in 2008 was a big hit to the party's popularity. And beyond 2008, or even before 2008, the collapse of the Soviet Union also was to the Chinese communists a very important historical lesson that they still feel the concern about this collapse of the Soviet Union, that they could see this kind of implication for the Chinese Communist Party. Taiwan also made a transition, peaceful political transition, to multi-party rule with the victory of the DPP, Democratic Progressive Party. And what scared the Chinese communists was that this party has run on a platform of Taiwan independence. So it was around that time, 2000, that the communists in China felt that their rule may not be secure because Taiwan is developing in an independent direction. And of course, just a few years before 2008, we saw the color revolutions in previous Soviet states, popular rebellion toppling autocratic rulers. And that sent a signal also to the Chinese Communist Party. Around 2008, 2009, internally to China, the Xinjiang, Tibet protests, massive rebellions, violent rebellion, again, worrying, very worrisome development to Beijing. Arab Spring, kind of connected to the meltdown in Wall Street, shows to the communists that popular rebellion could happen to enduring autocracies like Egypt and other places in the MENA region. And slow growth is a legitimacy crisis. So all these come together around this time, 2008, before and after, to produce the twin crises. And China reacted with two big strategies, going global, going digital. And that's the, you know, the two strategies that would be the focus of my talk today. Going global helps China to export overcapacity, to help it climb the value chain, to acquire advanced technology so that China could make the transition away from export, producing and exporting very cheap mass-produced products and to try to produce high-end products to earn more profit. Going global also helps the regime to fan nationalism, to strengthen its claim to be the representative of Chinese nationalism, that China could become a great nation again in the world of nations. Going global has been expressed by various labels of and policy names. Going West is the first generation of going global, which is, you know, developing the big West of China. And the same strategy, and I'll talk about those strategies and mechanisms in a moment, later on apply to going out, which was the official policy of going global around the year 2000. And then when Xi Jinping came to power, he sort of have his own signature campaign, which now called Belt and Road, but basically it's continuing the going out policy. Also under Xi Jinping, we have Made in China 2025, which is the project to acquire high-end technology from the West. Parallel to that, to going global is going digital. And here I'll talk about the alliance between big tech and big brother, an alliance that has recently falling apart a little bit at the seam. But basically is China trying to create growth as well as new strategies of governance within the country by promoting e-commerce as well as AI capacity. BAIT represents this kind of big tech industry. In China, we don't have Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, or Google, what has been called FANG. But instead, China has all the equivalents of FANG and is BAIT, Baidu, Alibaba, iQIYI, and Tencent. So basically, I'll be talking very briefly, though, about these two strategies, and I'll focus most of the time on how they go about doing going global and going digital, as well as assessing some of the consequences. Okay, let's first look at going global. How and so what? I always feel like we should think of global China as a bundle of power mechanisms. The advantage of this is to show that China is not alone. China is just one of many countries that try to expand its power abroad. And by looking at a more abstract level as power mechanisms that nation states could use to project their power, we sort of put China back into a kind of a broader perspective, a global perspective that shows parallels between the Chinese way of power and other countries' way of power to find the commonalities as well as differences. And my work has focused on three distinct kinds of power mechanism that China has used, but also which has been used by other countries. And we'll come to that in a minute. So economic statecraft is the use of economic means to achieve diplomatic or political goals. And the Chinese way of doing economic statecraft has a distinctive feature, which is the heavy use of state-owned enterprises, policy banks. And they are the drivers. They have their own interest in using this economic statecraft because they are the ones who would benefit in terms of enterprise profit, in terms of policy banks, again, the bottom line for the policy banks, and to score political point because it shows that they are supporting the central government. Economic statecraft takes the form of loans for infrastructure, and China always framed that as a win-win solution to those countries that accept these loans to build infrastructure. Economic statecraft by China also involves acquiring strategic resources at source, and this is very important for copper, which I study for some years in Zambia, but also more recently in the news is cobalt because of its central use, importance in electric cars. Acquiring strategic resource at source allows China to bypass the market. They are acquiring these mines so that they can, if the market fails or if there is a trade war or embargo, China will still be able to access strategic materials because they have ownership over the source. So they are acquiring a lot of mines. Made in China 2025, again, is for China to acquire technology in various sectors. But I would like to flag that another thing that they really want to acquire is not so much the technology or the companies themselves, but the power to set standard. The standard of 5G. That's why Huawei is such an important front line between China and the West, because it allows China to set standard. And setting standard from China, I talked to some Chinese officials, they made it very clear, it's the ultimate goal of China going abroad and is setting standard. They see it as a strategic advantage for China. And the use of state capital, we can talk about it if people are interested in. I wrote a whole book on the nature of state capital as a special kind of capital with distinct interest and behavior. So one way for China to go global is to use economic statecraft. The second mechanism is patron clientelism. Again, China is not the only country to use patron clientelism, which is the exchange of political allegiance and loyalty for economic or material rewards. But China has a whole apparatus called the United Front machinery to go global. Traditionally, United Front applies mostly to the Chinese diaspora, which now amount to 60 million people in 180 countries. But in more recent years, non-Chinese agents have been approached and co-opted to do the bidding for Beijing in exchange for all kinds of perks, including business opportunities and outright money. And sometimes patron clientelism as a mechanism of power could turn coercive. And there is a recent report by, I think, Freedom House called Transnational Repression. And that details many ways in which China, among other countries, are using transnational relationships to exercise coercion on dissidents or people that they object to. So patron clientelism is very active in Chinatown, among Chinese diaspora, but also targeting politicians in Western democracies, in Australia, New Zealand, in Canada. Very many scandals have been discovered recently that falls under this manipulation of power through patron clientelism, basically bribing foreign agents and Chinese agents in countries outside of China. The third mechanism of power that China has used intensively is what I call symbolic domination, which is the exercise of power through symbolic forms, through manipulating people's disposition, common sense, or habit of thought. And it's usually done through ownership of cultural industries, media outlets, controlling discourses, public discourses through controlling editorial of newspapers and other news media, print or digital, a lot of free contents written in various languages, promoting the Chinese worldviews, explaining current affairs through the lens of Chinese interest. If you go to Africa, for instance, you take a plane in you know, Zambia, Kenya, you know, you take out this magazine at seat pocket, and you will find Chinese related content. And these are supplied by Chinese government or Chinese agents for free for these magazines producers to insert in. And it gets into every corner of Africa. Of course, the most famous or infamous example of the exercise of symbolic domination is through the establishment and classes in the Confucius Institutes and classrooms trying to promote Chinese culture and cultural practices. Also, elite tour to China, elite meaning officials, academics, scientists, people with power and influence in their own country are always invited to China, all expenses paid, and they would be given a very rosy view or to show off all the accomplishments in Chinese cities and in training workshop too, to shape their worldview, to create a kind of pro-China dispositions. So these are the bundles of power mechanisms that define global China as a phenomenon. The question then is, well, we now know how, then so what? The scholarship for students. So what? You see something that you should see later. Let's look at economic stagecraft. How effective has that been? Well, it has seen some successes, but lots of problems. Some countries have, of course, sided with China because of all those infrastructures and the loans. But there are studies also showing that overcapacity has not improved, a problem that was the one of the incentives to drive China to go global, to export overcapacity. It hasn't solved that problem, in terms of steel and cement consumption, glass and all that. What it has also generated is reproducing the same problem that we have seen, which is endemic to the Chinese system, is that anarchy of competition among local and institutional agents. Remember those SOEs and local governments who would stand to benefit from going abroad with all sorts of loan projects and infrastructure projects? The same kind of anarchic competition that we found within China has happened outside of China. Those loans, I've studied how those loans come about, and usually it's driven by those construction companies who stand to benefit from having more and more loan projects. And they would line up the loans and then they would sell these loans to foreign government and say, hey, I can build you this road that would win you the election. You don't have to pay, or it will be paid by your government, but not during on your watch, because you'll be gone by the time 20 years later when the loan is mature and has to be paid. And so there is a lot of moral hazard built into the concessional loan financing that China has been using to go abroad, to go out, to go global, and to exercise economic stagecraft. The moral hazard has come back to hurt China, because many of these loans do not benefit China or the country. And as a matter of fact, these many roads and bridges are going nowhere. They're not generating economic development. And these many countries cannot pay off the loan, and who is going to suffer? So in addition to the moral hazard and the financial losses incurred by these loans, these projects have run into all sorts of problems, operational problems, the gauges, they don't match, labor problems, community resistance, And of course, political challenges. Whenever there is a new election, the new elite may not recognize, may not want to continue with the projects that have been signed off by the previous regime, administration. The Financial Times 2 years ago has put out a very incisive report investigating 18 high-speed rail projects that China have commissioned to build. And the result is very astonishing. The result is the value of abandoned Chinese rail projects overseas was double the value of those projects that are continuing or in operation. So there's all these hidden losses under this column of economic statecraft. Oops. How about patron clientelism? Patron clientelism, yes, has allowed China to do a lot of political co-optation, but we also have empirical research that are coming out by a young generation of scholars doing global China studies that those people that China tries to co-opt actually were very skilled at appropriating the material benefits that China gave them to benefit their own without actually benefiting China or doing the bidding for China. There are a lot of scandals involved in these so-called local diaspora elite, the Chinese local elites helping the Chinese government, and which caused a lot of reputational damage to China, as well as financial damage. And the control over the Chinese diaspora is not perfect because there are divisions within the Chinese diaspora. The Chinese diaspora also have people who are leaning towards Taiwan and more recently to Hong Kong. So we've seen more recent internal conflicts among the Chinese overseas population. That means that patron clientelism or United Front work does not always generate the results that Beijing had hoped for. And then because of the political co-optation cases involving elected officials, foreign governments have been very sensitive to what they've called sharp power. There's a report by Hoover Institution at Stanford highlighting the various ways in which sharp power has been exercised. And that has led to foreign governments' effort to legislate against political infiltration by China. And particularly the Five Eyes Alliance have joined forces to monitor China's exercise of infiltration, which here I call patron clientelism. So the West has been put on alert and have come up with concrete responses to keep patron clientelism at bay. So again, questionable result or effectiveness for China. How about symbolic domination? Has it worked? Well, the Confucius Institutes have come under attack by the US and other European countries, including Germany, by the way. Half of the 70 or 80 Confucius Institutes in the US have been closed in the past couple of years. And for those who have not been closed, empirical research also show that in Africa, for instance, a friend of mine has done a very exciting study on the Confucius Institute in Ethiopia. And what she found is that, yes, you know, Ethiopians go to attend Confucius Institute classes, but not because they really are favorable to China or have been favorably affected to support China or Chinese culture. They looked at Confucius Institute classes as a way to increase their labor market work opportunity. Speaking Chinese would allow, you know, people in poor countries more job opportunities. That's the way they appropriate the Confucius Institute, not as a, you know, they're not becoming more favorable to Chinese values the way that Beijing would like to see. Media control, CGTN, the Chinese global TV networks have been, again, under attack as a tool of Beijing controlling its editorial. And I think the UK has banned CGTN, saying that it is a foreign agent. Popular opinions, if you look at Pew Research Center's over time chronological tracking of popular opinions in 12 or 15 advanced democracies in the West. Their opinion polls towards China, asking people whether they're favorably disposed towards China. And the trend has been going down for the past 15 years, and especially since COVID. So China is not winning support through symbolic domination. But what has happened is all these negative opinion about China abroad has actually helped fanning more nationalism at home, because the official rhetoric frames these negative attacks on China as as the West continuing to humiliate China. Western humiliation of China for 100 years is the official line that has been propagated at home to help the Chinese interpret these negative opinion poll about China and all these pushback at Chinese attempts to go abroad, whether we're talking about economic statecraft, symbolic domination, or patron clientelism. Okay, let's move on. Let me check time. To talk about the second major elite strategy in response to the accumulation and legitimation crisis in the aftermath of 2008. And that is going digital. Going digital is both about growing the economy, but also strengthening the regime's control over the population. So it's a growth and a governance project. Digital China, we can think about digital China through this idea that has been suggested by sociologists, political scientists in the US to talk about the West, and that is surveillance capitalism, the use of data, big data, about every aspect of our lives for profit accumulation. So in the West, we have surveillance capitalism, and the major actors, of course, are Facebook, Google, and the like. But in China, we have surveillance state capitalism in the sense that the Chinese, while they have restricted the entry of US-based digital companies, the big tech companies called FANG, it has promoted its own homegrown national champion that can profit from surveillance capitalism and enter into an alliance with the regime to promote surveillance state capitalism. And they have some successes, because by restricting entry of these Western companies, China has been able to grow and develop and innovate within its own territory, benefiting from a huge economy, the second largest, and a huge population. And within the space of the past 10 years or so, it has developed the world's largest platform economy in terms of revenue and employment, and has become the leader in some sector of the platform economy, most notably in e-commerce, accounting for 40% of the world's total transaction in e-commerce. Its volume of transaction, if you look at the statistics, is much bigger than Amazon. And in fintech, it has led the world, accounting for 70% of the world's transaction in e-banking, fintech, by the company Alibaba, and as a subsidiary of Alibaba. It has leapfrogged technological development, developed something that the West has not seen, which is a very centralized super platform, WeChat. With WeChat is one app, you do everything on WeChat. And it's like you have 10 apps that are separate in the US combined as one. And people can do simultaneously. You can watch live streamers talking about anything while you shop what you see on screen, and do transactions, talk to your friend, send messages. It's just like all the FANG combined into WeChat. And the result is the velocity of transaction of the market economy in China is so much faster. And that's why Chinese coming to the US or to Europe find everything so slow, because in China, there is these super platforms that allow you to do in real time, 10 times as much as what you could do in real time in the West. And think of that, you know, the speed of the economy of market transaction is so much faster in China. And the government has very explicitly stated and conceptualized and theorized information as a factor of production. And it is treating data, big data, like it treats state-owned enterprises, machinery production, copper mines, and strategic material. And so there's a policy towards information. The government invests heavily in these high-tech companies, the Alibaba, you know, you name it, Tencent, Baidu. They all have significant state investment. The state provides subsidies for these companies to innovate. The party establish party branches in these big high-tech companies, and it has imposed legal requirements for them to share data with the government. So there is this deep alliance, very much and much more entrenched, and in China between big tech and big brother, which allows the government to exercise and to implement digital authoritarianism, the surveillance industrial complex with state and industry joining together in so many different ways, organizationally, legally, financially. And one big advantage for China to develop surveillance state capitalism is just because it has the largest population on earth, and which allows AI machine learning to be developed much more based on a much larger pool of data collection, and combine that with lax regulation, no protection of right to privacy. China is sitting on top of the largest pool of data to allow AI to learn much faster and much deeper than other countries. And so recently, the US government, I think one of the national security branches, have put out a report saying that China is destined to surpass the US to become the world's biggest and most powerful AI superpower. I think a big reason is because of this lethal combination of Chinese population being the largest, as well as very little restriction on the government's power to collect data. And one infamous example, of course, that has been implemented nationwide is the social credit system, which now uses integrated big data on 1.02 billion citizens in China, their digital biographies, anything from their DNA to their marital history, to their credit history, to their social relationships and the way they walk, their behavior, how many traffic violations they've committed, everything. We're talking about 1.02 billion digital biographies at the disposal of the government that the government can use to do a lot of things. And notorious example in Xinjiang, which many people now consider the world's largest open air digital prison. And we're not just talking about cameras everywhere, in every corner of the train station or street corner or your neighborhood, outside your home. We are talking about citizens in Xinjiang being forced to install apps on their cell phone, on their smartphone, to do what? To monitor their digital footprint, to see whether they're reading so-called terrorist materials, whether they're consulting religious texts that are objectionable to the regime, whether they're reading, you know, or going to websites of other Muslim organizations overseas. So anything you do online is being tracked by this app that the government forced upon you. So it is really personal. You're carrying the state with you in your pocket, basically, and officials can monitor every single thing, any single push on your own cell phone. combine that with a very traditional way of managing society, and that is the grid management method. In any city, any village you go, the territory is divided into grid, really a grid. It's like a, you know, a square. When I was doing fieldwork a couple of years ago, the grid officials, so every single grid is the responsibility of, I think, three officials in cities. And these three officials will be responsible for anything that happened within the grid. And they'll be walking, patrolling the grid day and night in stairwells as well as the streets. They know every single person in the grid, which at that time, in a big city, every grid is about several thousand people, sorry, households. And they know everything that is happening. And with the aid of personal relationship combined with big data, covering everything happening in that territory, that grid, what the Chinese government is doing is combining traditional human intelligence with big data intelligence. And they run algorithm and to make decision, not just to crack down on protest, but to do something really innovative, which is to prevent something from happening. Taking preemptive strike at something that has not yet happened. So for instance, some citizens or some workers talking about pulling off a strike. Well, before the strike actually happens, the government can come in to stop the process of you talking together, conspiring, or organizing, planning your strike action. And not just that, well, because they monitor the wording that you use, they could stop the process. And not just that, they would know you, know who you are. They know your family situation to identify the vulnerable spot that when they come to stop you, to talk you out of doing the strike, they know what method would work best. So for instance, you have, let's say, a disabled child, you have an unemployed spouse, you have this and that need in your personal life, and the official would come with that information in hand and propose something that would work. They would know in the past, you have led another protest or another visit to the government office, and their past method didn't work. They would not use that method this time. So they know you, as well as having the tool to preemptively stop what you're doing. I think this is a very powerful method that I don't imagine other regimes would do. But China, with a very long tradition of using human intelligence to monitor and to maintain stability, now has this additional tool of big data. Okay, so very quickly, how effective is digital going digital in delivering growth and stability? Well, it's very effective so far in delivering growth. 50 to 68% of economic growth in the past few years comes from the digital economy or the platform economy, and which now accounts for 36% of GDP, according to Chinese statistics. It has become part of going global as China exports surveillance technology to 73 countries as part of the Belt and Road Initiative. But it has also generated or produced socioeconomic polarization. What is so interesting and important to note is that not everybody is getting wealthy in digital China under the platform economy. The premier has pointed out multiple times that China still has a huge population of very low income households. 43% of the population earn a monthly income of $140, which is very little, even in China. And he pointed out that China has a huge so-called street vending economy, which is an informal economy, another word for precarious informal economy. So a lot of people are suffering beneath this very spectacular growth rate generated by the by going digital. How about governance? Now in governance, I think I have a colleague in Hong Kong who has done the most spectacular big data analysis on the use, on the government's use of big data in terms of preempting or preventing or managing protest. And his finding is really sobering. The Chinese government is really successful in maintaining stability with the use of surveillance. Between 2013 to 17, protest all over China nationwide has, the number of protests have declined from 900 a month to 600 a month, one third decline. What is also important is not just the aggregate number of protests, but also decreasing the number of participants. These protests become less violent. They less likely target the state. And as a result, the regime does not have to use that much police force. And so in terms of stability, yes, the answer is quite clearly that the government is achieving its goal of governance and stability maintenance using big data. In COVID time, particularly the grid management combined with the social credit system, the control of biometric data, and controlling mobility within every single neighborhood through the grid system, has allowed the Chinese to control the spread of the virus and expand infrastructural state power. However, there are some hidden conflicts and tensions. There are two types of class warfare that has emerged related to going digital. One, I'm sure you've heard of, the government is now cracking down on the IT giants. Those big tech companies have now come under tremendous pressure and legal restrictions, both to share data with the state, but also in terms of controlling its finances. These companies are coerced to so-called donate its profit to support the government's new campaign of common prosperity. That is, they're earning too much. The government wants to take away the profit in the name of serving the people. Now, is it just in name? Common prosperity, basically, is state controlling these companies and some of these CEOs, very high-flying, famous people like Jack Ma, has been in hiding from state repression, various forms of state repression. And some companies have been asked to delist or to cancel their IPO on Wall Street or in Hong Kong. On the labor side, digital labor resistance has lately taken on a very interesting phenomenon, a widespread movement with the name lying flat or lying flatism, a direct translation from a Chinese phrase, meaning that people are, and many people, they don't need to bang together to protest. They are pursuing this individual, but massive number of individual resistance by chilling out. They don't want to consume, they don't want to work hard, they don't want to do overtime, they don't want to buy property, they don't want to advance. They just say, I'm giving up, I want to live day to day, I don't have ambition. And this has generated a huge propaganda reaction from the state, from the government and the party, condemning lying flatism because they see that, they know what is going on. And this is a massive popular movement. And when people are saying that I'm not going to strive to do better, I'm not going to pursue the China dream that Xi Jinping has been talking about, well, the state sees trouble because it's another way of protesting against the state. So governance has suffered at the elite level and also at the mass level. I should say not governance, but in terms of, you know, hidden tension, class warfares in these two forms. I'm coming to my conclusion, my last slide, which is to sort of bring us back to the question of going global and going digital, these Chinese responses to 2008. To what extent is China exceptional? As China, the Chinese government, the regime always seems to be saying to the world that China is different, Chinese characteristics of this and that, and not just different, but better. And then the West trying to pass China as exceptional as well, but in the bad way, that China is uniquely repressive and authoritarian and aggressive. What can we say after reviewing what China has been doing, going global and going digital, as a response to the world financial crisis, 2008? Well, my argument is that it's not exceptional. When we talk about surveillance state capitalism, we in the West have surveillance capitalism, and it's not exercised by the state, but we've seen how Facebook and Google and the like have been used in election, has been helping fanning all kinds of hate crime and hate speech for profit purpose. So we see political weaponization of big data as well as commodification of data. So in the West, as much as in China, we see this. Maybe the difference in China is that the state is the one doing it, and therefore it has a heavier presence, is more visible, is not the invisible hand of the market, but the visible and heavy hands of the state. And so it just invites more criticism. But I think similar dynamics of big data driving both profit as well as state control are happening everywhere, not just in China. Securitization. When China cracks down within its border, or when it uses big data for maintaining law and order, it always mentions security. We are doing so because of national security. We are doing so in Xinjiang against terrorism, splittism, and so on and so forth. But China is not the only country appealing to national security law or national security as the excuse to increase executive power. As a matter of fact, China is following the trend set up by the US in a post 9/11 world, and it has appropriated the rhetoric of war on terror. You can find war on terror in Chinese documents, and we all know war on terror was President Bush's excuse for a number of flagrant violation of human rights. In Xinjiang, they have concentration camp, but don't forget, in the US, the US has run Abu Ghraib and Guantanamo for years, and they're still prisoners held up indefinitely for a longer period of time for the sake of, in the name of national security. And the US is not the only country. After 9/11, 10, 15 years after the period after 9/11, I read an article by a legal scholar, 140 countries have implemented their own version of national security law that gives the executive tremendous sweeping power in the name of national security to violate and curb civil rights in their own country. And remember Snowden, his exposure of the US National Security Agency, USA, the programs of spying on their own citizens, as well as spying on Google and Facebook and all these companies, PRISM and muscular programs. So, I mean, the point I want to make is that China is not exceptional in appealing to national security to use big data in ways that goes beyond promoting growth. Economic statecraft by the Chinese has been, criticized widely for creating debt trap, using those infrastructure projects that put creating debt burdens on these countries, and therefore who would become then supportive of China's diplomatic moves in the international arena. But let's remind ourselves that building infrastructure as a means, as a leverage to influence political authorities in other countries, has been pioneered by the World Bank in the post-World War II era, when they were interested in infrastructure building, as well as lending loans to third world countries, the IMF, and in exchange for what? These countries have to do structural adjustment, basically following the blueprint, the government and economic philosophy of small government, leaving a lot of room to the market, neoliberalization in Africa, Latin America, and Asia. So that trap, another form of that trap, predated the Chinese concessional loan model. And I think China might have taken the lesson, you know, Lee, from the book, the playbook of the World Bank, as well as IMF. So the last point is, China is different, that is at war with Washington, that people are saying, well, we're entering this era of new Cold War and a great decoupling between China and the West. But I think you look deeper and you would see that actually the West has been complicit in what China has been doing, going global and going digital. Wall Street, as we speak, as Washington and China and Beijing were at war with each other, Wall Street has expanded. Just look at the number. The New York Times reported a few days ago, this year, 2021, up to now, the first 9 months, $100 billion investment has gone from Wall Street firms into China. So Wall Street's interest definitely is very different from Washington. The same with Silicon Valley. Apple, just yesterday, I saw this report. Apple, Tim Cook, has been personally negotiating with Beijing to allow Apple to continue to be the most popular iPhone company in China. In exchange, Apple has agreed that in its app store in China, you buy an iPhone in China, the app store there, you will not find apps for praying apps for Muslims. And that is the concession Apple has been made to help the regime control or neutralize or change the Uyghur population's way of life in Xinjiang with the help of Apple. So Apple or other Western companies, Silicon Valley has helped develop many of these high-tech surveillance technology that now China exports to the rest of the world. Universities, MIT, University of Michigan. I mean, I can point you to sources pointing out that surveillance technology in China, they're not developing those technology alone. They're lucrative contracts from the West in these projects that end up being used or owned by Chinese companies and then export. So let's pay attention to all this complicity, collaboration, and collusion between the West and China, and any suggestion that China is out there and the West is here and there's no connection and China is exceptional is really untenable. What I think would be really unique when we look at China in its competition or collusion with the West or in comparison with the West, there may be others, but my own argument is that China really is different in one key aspect, and that is that it is ruled by one party and a very, very strong, robust party. And therefore, as a result, it has infinite time horizon. They can plan, they can make 100 years plan. They can groom somebody 20 years before they come to use this particular person who has been, you know, groomed to support them in the university or in the government or in an organization. Because people don't anticipate this party to go away. There's no election that would remove the party. And so it can really strategize in the long term. It could invest in a mine, a money-losing mine, at the moment, but because it looks at the time horizon of 20, 50, 100 years, it can, and with the party state behind it, with just very lavish budget, it could do a lot of things that no private company or no democratic country or government could do, because you have election cycle in democracies. Party would be replaced, leadership could be replaced, and politicians are so much bound by the election cycle every 5 years or 7 years in France or whatnot. And that's the time frame. But for China and communist administration regime, they look at much longer time frame. And as a result, they can invest in much longer term development, be it, you know, in mines or in promoting or grooming his own agents, or in planning things, acquiring technology. So I think this is what I come to thinking about China, is the one party rule giving it just tremendous advantage. And it just really is about infinite time horizon for a very powerful organization wielding so much financial resources now. And that is what I would say is the Chinese exception. But other than that, there are a lot of things that China does that we can find echoes and parallels in the rest of the world. So I'm sorry I've been talking far longer than I wanted to, planned to, but I hope you have a lot of ideas and questions for me.
All right, Professor Lee, thank you so much for this very rich and also nuanced talk, very systematic, very, very good to follow, and bringing us up to speed to the latest developments, and really also present them in a very, very good overview. Thank you very much. We do have roughly 20 minutes plus time for Q&A. We do have a couple of questions in the F&A chat here. I would like to take the privilege of being the moderator to ask the first question and combine it then with, because it kind of fits nicely together, I think, or it's kind of related with one question here from the chat. So my question would be, Professor Lee, you framed it, and I think it's a very interesting and to the point frame of the two modalities of class warfare. And you mentioned that ongoing battle, so to say, between the state, the party state, and the IT companies. And you also mentioned the reasons why the Chinese government is doing that. But I sometimes wonder, I mean, they cutting off, and you also mentioned it potentially at least a huge growth engine, right? I mean, how don't they see the risk? Obviously they do see the risk, but so they have evaluated the necessity for control here is a larger one than kind of shrinking or breaking up or stopping the economic dynamics that have been linked to the IT company. So yeah, how do we evaluate that a little more? That would be my question. And I would like to add one question, the second one in the chat, which is referring to the latest developments of China's, so to say, new protectionism, which is, so to say, the flip side, I would argue, of growing control over the private sector and growing protectionism, for example, also by tightening data to transfer protection vis-a-vis foreign companies. So how would you evaluate this new protectionism? Is that linked to a new strengthening movement? So wanted to be more autonomous or self-sufficient, so to say. How would you evaluate those? So those two questions as a kickoff, if we may.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. I mean, great questions. There's a trade-off, obviously, between growth generated by the AI and, you know, the high-tech information technology sector, and stop growth. But the party state is trying to exert political control and making a big stand to the IT titans to make them realize who is in control and is the party, that they could stop you from listing overseas, because after all, you are a Chinese company, you register here, we have control over you. Now there's a trade-off there, definitely. And what is the timing here is very important. I think next year, 2022 or 23, I'm just blinking out on the exact time date, there'll be a big party conference where Xi Jinping would be consolidated, affirmed as the third term, his third term, after he eliminate any constitutional limit on his presidency.
Next year, 2022.
So a lot of people are talking about this crackdown is to make sure that there is no opposition or kind of developing opposition, countervailing power within China itself, that it wants to show, Xi Jinping himself wants to really make a big political statement that he is in control. And if he wants these companies to go small, he can. And that is with his own personal political career in as the important right now, as the priority. And also these companies, I mean, this crackdown is not like to say that, you know, they can't function or they can't continue the business. It's just to curb what they can do. It will have an effect, because then people will now be concerned about, you know, how far innovation could go, but the immediate effect would not be so drastic, because they are still in control of China as a huge market. And Xi Jinping himself has been talking about internal circulation of the economy, that is, they are relying on domestic consumption more. And so I think we would still continue to see growth, but perhaps not as vigorous as the growth rate may not be as big as we have seen. But the whole world has been slowing. So the regime could also point to, well, we're not that bad after all, compared to, you know, the rest of the world. And so the protectionism, yes. What I think what in China and many observers of China have said is right now the policy is data localization, which is any companies like Apple or Tesla. Tesla is the latest company which has agreed to localize, to establish and create data center inside China. And they have to abide by Chinese laws regarding who have access to the data, but definitely those data will stay in China. So if you're a Tesla owner, all your travel footprint that Tesla will have in the computer system have to stay in China. And we don't know whether the Chinese government could just arbitrarily tap into that database or not, but at least is in China, you can't offshore it, and for later use for the Chinese company. And very sadly, of course, is the fact that many high-tech companies are agreeing, and they just say that we have, you know, we can't not agree to the national law in the destination of the investment. So it's not so much protectionism, it's protectionism in the sense of setting up more barriers for these companies. But I think the general strategy is really data localization. As I said, the government looks at data as a factor of production. So we'll think of it as like nationalization of data. By nationalization, I mean not really, you know, all the people owning these data. It's the party state that owns the data in the name of the nation. And so what they don't want is even for Chinese companies to offshore their data. Chinese company and Western companies have to stay in China so that the government can have access to the data whenever it wants as a factor of production. And a crackdown on, let's say, TikTok or some of these is a strange spectrum of crackdown. We're seeing they are cracking down on celebrities, they're cracking down on TV shows, they are cracking down on fan organizations. You can't have too many fans. And they're cracking down on the number of hours that young people could play video game. I mean, you would wonder why. I mean, all these is a way to channel data and the data industry to productive users rather than to these kind of hobby, and that would poison people's mind. So it's a very strategic economic use of data, and they want these companies to not just get profit, but to really innovate in a way that allows China to keep ahead of the West in productive technology.
Super, thank you very much. And yeah, I was just informed by the hosts of tonight's event, the Einstein Forum, that we could go a little longer, Professor Lee, if that's okay with you, like yes, 10 or 15 minutes, that would be sure. Great. And also for the audience, especially for the registered participants, you may also raise your hand so we can grant you the opportunity, because yeah, technically that's possible. We could open, if you wanted to, you could open your mic and ask your question directly. And we do have a raised hand here. Before I would turn it over to the person who has raised his hand, I think, Louis, I would like to read two more questions from the chat. First, actually, that came in was about the startup strategies, and so to say, what the anonymous from anonymous view from the audience ask here, a hype that is often kind of portrayed that China is really leading and advancing in everything. And there are, and you also mentioned that, clearly very innovative and amazing and groundbreaking developments. But he or she is asking, how do we kind of unmask or counter that kind of hype? Are there any specific sources you would point researchers to present a more nuanced or balanced view of the innovative capacity for example, Chinese startup companies or IT companies in general? How do you research such things? Well, and the second question, yeah, if I may, I just would bundle two questions again, if that's okay.
Sure, yes, please, yes.
The second question would be, if you, in your analysis, because you mentioned the US at the very end as a reference in the sense of that China is a very diligent student, so to say, of the US in many ways, do you see any difference between Europe in the US in terms of those global developments in terms of securitization or state capitalism? Yeah, let's tackle those two questions first. Thank you.
Great. how to research China or this high-tech sector, surveillance state capitalism? Well, surprisingly, securitization has become one of the most productive area of China studies. The younger generation, I mean, China scholars are catching up with the Chinese state in the sense that I have seen so many really exciting research projects ongoing, as well as some that are being published, using big data to look at big data in China and look at how the state is using big data. There are people doing it, and I can, you know, point you to one of my colleagues. Kristen mentioned that I spent time in Hong Kong in the past 2 years when I was on leave from UCLA and got under attack. During that period, I got to know some colleagues in Hong Kong. And if you go, you can look up my dean, my boss, Kelly Tsai, who also used to be in the US and moved to Hong Kong. She is conducting some very exciting research with her PhD students studying in Hong Kong on the IT industry and the surveillance industrial complex, those companies how they collaborate with government, where they export and so on and so forth. So there are people doing this kind of research. Now, you need to have special access. And China has a huge population and a lot of relationships. And if you are lucky, there are people who can find direct and indirect relationship that would get researchers into this very complex web of collusion of interest. US and Europe, now, correct me if I'm wrong, you guys are in Europe, you should know better, that it seems like US is always the leader in the so-called free world, and look at the boycott of the Winter Olympic. Many countries follow the US footsteps and would do what the US would like to see happening. But Europe, like Germany, I think Germany and France, these leaders of the European Union, they also have their own interest. And I think it depends on the politician, whether commercial interest, economic interest in China, Trump, political grandstanding, that is a variable. I think it depends on the issue. It depends on the timing, on particular political climate, the electorate, and whether there's popular support for this and that. But we've seen that European companies are doing similar things like what Apple and Google and all these are doing. And they are also a very powerful lobby sector influencing European politicians. So I'm not surprised that similar dynamics are happening, that European companies are also helping the Chinese to develop these fancy AI-powered surveillance technology, and which that then get exported to Africa or Venezuela and, you know, all these autocratic regimes. So to me, I think when I say China is not exceptional, a lot of times we have to reinstate capitalism as the outside where China is a part of. And, you know, think about Xinjiang, who is benefiting from Xinjiang cotton, you know, is all these companies that rely on cheap and slave labor, detained labor, prison labor in Xinjiang to pick those cotton that get into our t-shirts and everywhere. And these are global companies. So there is the external condition of what China is doing oftentimes point us back to capitalism, capitalist interest, which when it gets to China got kind of overlapped with communist state power. And what in the West, we always see the state power part without seeing the capitalist part, because the state has very clumsy hands, and the state, the Chinese state in particular, always reinforced this idea China is different. And so people see, oh, China is different and it's authoritarian and it's singular, but it's not. And it's in so many different ways part of and in collusion with capitalism. And that's what I think we need to see is both authoritarianism, communism, but also capitalism. And I think Europe is part of this capitalism, so Europe must be part of this.
Right. I mean, exactly. Yes. I think it's basically probably in the IT realm that we don't have that much to offer as the US, right? That's probably partly why that's not so much linked to Europe. Although some companies, of course, in the industrial realm. But yeah, I think that's very important what you mentioned. I think it's probably also not that we don't see it, but it's much more uncomfortable to face that side of things, right? Because then, as you rightly pointed out, then so many Western companies are also involved and kind of have facilitated basically the rise of China in that realm.
Actually, the German company, the robotic, what is your biggest robotic company? Something like
KUKA, right? Yeah, that KUKA was kind of taken over the Chinese company, yes. Media, they invested into KUKA. Yeah, that's true. We have some hidden champions, though. That's definitely true, yeah. I would like to invite, if I guess it's a he, I apologize if I made your wrong assumptions, if Louis Klein would like to pose his question. Then you're welcome to open your mic and ask your question, Louis.
Okay. I hope my mic is open. Can you hear me?
Yes, very well. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much for that lovely presentation and that really informative evening. I am very much enjoyed it. What occurred to me, and hence my question, is to what extent are we looking in the definition of the state of something that goes beyond the monopoly of violence towards a monopoly of governance? If I look at the Chinese state, as you described it, and as we see it from many, many sources, that there is, the classical definition of a state is very much looking on weapons, weaponry, and the power of, and that the power of weapons remains with the state. But as you described it, and as it occurred to me, the Chinese state seems to go even one step further and keeps a firm hand on governance as the possibility to organize for whatever kind of emergence, be it unions, be it protests, be it you name it. And we've seen a harsh intervention, almost for the Western eye, overly harsh intervention on Falun Gong, for example, if you go back. And to what degree is that heading into that direction? And as a double-sided sword, how does that feed into, in alliance with what you said about the infinite time horizon, as to the entire ecological challenge that we're looking at in terms of climate change and so on? What is happening there? Is that a conscious trend to say we have a firm grip on governance and without possibilities to rule in a far more long horizon perspective, or what is actually happening there? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Louis. Big question, very good question. I think we should be thinking about the questions that you raise. I have two responses. First of all, is the first point you make, that it seems like the Chinese government, the regime, it goes beyond monopoly of violence as a state. And I totally agree with you. And I want to point out something I didn't have a chance to talk about in this presentation, is there's something that observers from the outside often miss. And I'm not a native to the mainland Chinese society, but I've studied enough, go there enough to do my research, that what I've come out, that really striking kind of finding to myself, is that coercion is just one part of the Chinese state. What it does marvelously, I would say, and kind of invisible to people who don't really live in China, is the consent. It's not just coercion, that monopoly of violence that you mentioned, is the tremendous consent among the local population that the Communist Party has over time created. Take, for instance, Xinjiang. I mean, the whole world condemns China's atrocities in Xinjiang. But if you talk to a local Chinese, they would buy the rhetoric of terrorism, of separating the country, of independence, of violence, that therefore we need extreme measures to control the rebellious population in Xinjiang. And a local Chinese, an average local Chinese would even tell you that the government has given Xinjiang a lot of special privileges and subsidies to bring a very backward region of the country and allow it to grow in 20 years. You know, people have improved their income and livelihood and so on and so forth. And so I want to highlight this part of consent and nationalism. Let me think about in the day and age of internet connectivity and information, nationalism, ultra-nationalism has intensified to the extent that even visiting scholars to UCLA, when I talk to them, their knee-jerk reaction is to accept that China has been under attack. And the news in the West, a lot of that is fake news. They wouldn't even accept some negative reports that they read here in the US, reported by the New York Times about, you know, arresting feminists in China. And this is a real example. The first reaction of that visiting scholar, the day when the five feminists were arrested a couple of years back, was, oh, this is fake news, you know, perpetrated by the West. We don't have time, but I will need another talk to talk about all the mechanisms that the Chinese party state has used to create this popularity. There's a team of Harvard researchers doing opinion poll over time in China. And it was so depressing to see their report, which is that most people really over time, and it's not just one poll, two polls, it's over time, was extremely supportive of Xi Jinping himself. And what's behind those figures? I can talk, I mean, bring me back next year, I'll talk about that particular issue of the infrastructural state, creating consent in an authoritarian regime. So yes, not just a monopoly of violence, but monopoly of consent creation mechanism as well. Now, ecology, one would think that given this infinite time horizon, given that the party state has so much control, and not subjected vulnerable to these election cycles where, you know, environmental policies come and go depending on who's get elected, and nobody thinking in the long term to solve this civilizational problem, a planetary problem. China, yes, I think in terms of the tackling ecological crisis, China should have, in theory, the best political system, let's say, to really look in the long run and come up with solutions. But again, as with the problem of overaccumulation that I started my talk with, if China is so smart, then it shouldn't have this problem of anarchic competition that creating excess amounts of redundant productive capacity, which compel it to go abroad in order to maintain profit. What happened is the central government could come up with the best plan for anything they could, but the system itself has so many layers of powers. If you look beyond the central government, you see all these local agents having their own interest, and they always improvise and resist central policy dictate to come up with their own solution while also advancing their career, but defeating the rational projects announced at the center. So having a central government that has been believed to be by the people that will last forever, we don't see any alternative power challenging it, really create that consent and the compliance that the center wants. But within the system, it is really actually very fragmented. Actually, political scientists of China talk about fragmented authoritarianism. And that is why the fragmentation and all these competing bureaucratic interests, local interest, is the reason why China has found itself in so many problems, despite having like this all-competent, all-knowing, smart state. It is not immune to problems that it can't control. And I think with ecological policies as well, they may come up with plans to do this, to turn solar and whatnot, but guess what? The SOEs, what about those SOEs who are still mining and using coal? They have their own interests, and that is a big sector. To have them ignore their own interests and just go all the way to green technology is just not doable, because these are huge companies connected to different ministries, and they are just the stakeholders in not going green. And they are connected to politicians at the very top. So it's a very complex system. That doesn't mean that once you make a decision at the top, and then the environment will be cleaner. And we see the environment in China and it's not working for China. And I don't think it would work for China to come up with global solutions and that would solve global problem.
Thank you very much. I will read two more questions from the chat, and then we have another participant who raised her hand. That's probably then the final question looking at our time right now. But yeah, so first of all, two questions from the chat. The first one is about if you also attribute any, so to say, positive or potentially positive dimensions to the digitization, positive in the sense of not only for the party states controlling everything, but basically here Thomas is mentioning positive effects on planning schemes, socialist planning schemes, or a more effective economic redistribution. So can digitalization, do you also see a from a social, more social justice point of view, do you see any positive effect here? And he links that again also, and we talked a little bit about that, that was my question, to the future relationship between the private companies, the capitalists, to say, especially the IT companies, and the party state, if the party state doesn't have to pay a price economically if they try increasingly to control them. We talked about that already. So maybe the first part, the positive side from a social justice point of view. And the second question is if the Chinese government have underestimated or haven't foreseen the backlash against their charming efforts, for example, like vaccine diplomacy, but also early on you mentioned the moral hazard related to free loans, which kind of backlashed. So yeah, two different questions, but yeah, two very interesting ones. Professor Lee, over to you.
Right. The first one, the positive effect of digital China. If you ask the Chinese people, they would point to security. They want security. Who doesn't want security? And the Chinese, you know, you talk to those grannies walking in the neighborhood, they would, and I've seen reports about them, that they said crime is really down for crime control, especially for urban residents. They are seeing less migrant workers, strangers coming in and out of the neighborhood. They like the digitization for service delivery, government service delivery, which, by the way, is also the reason, the kind of argument made by the government as to why we install so many cameras, why we need all these digital devices and capturing of your all kinds of personal data, is for better deliver our service, you know. And smart city, again, China is not the only country where there's this huge campaign and movement to turn cities into smart cities, again, in the name of either from savings energy to easier traffic, less traffic jams. And so all these are the convenience you know, for the enjoyment of life kind of reasons that digital technology have facilitated and are welcomed by the local population. In terms of equity, what we have seen, and I'm actually ultimately I'm not sure it has that effect in a wide scale, but we also see people with little education, especially those who are isolated in the countryside. Now digital technology has created a whole new population, whole new group of live streamers who apparently have been very successful in making money by just showing their everyday life or showing, you know, live streaming. I don't know whether you have that equivalent in Germany, but in China, a lot of people seem to be able to make huge amount of money crowdfunding a particular live streamer celebrity. And many of them are ordinary peasants, women, in the countryside, documenting their everyday life where people would donate money to them, or they would sell in the program, in their broadcast, this and that product, and that get a commission. So I think digital technology has allowed people this kind of new venues of livelihood, new sources of income, and some of them have nowhere to turn because they're just so isolated in a vast countryside. And now they have this opportunity. But, you know, we shouldn't think that everybody is using the smartphone to become live streamer that really earn real money. So I have to think more. Are there other examples where digital technology has helped creating more equality? I'm not so sure. Can you remind me the second question?
Sure, of course. That was a question about whether or not the Chinese government simply has underestimated the backlash against their going global efforts in terms of, yeah, pushback. You mentioned more hazard loans, but also the vaccine diplomacy kind of backlash, at least to some extent. So have they underestimated, they were overconfident, so to say, or what has happened here?
Well, I don't know. I wish I had access to their minds. And whether they at the beginning didn't anticipate that, but I think they're well equipped to prepare and manage expectations. I mean, one thing I found about the Chinese regime is that they're very good at managing popular expectations. So when the economy is slowing down, they didn't hide it to the people. Actually, government reports, important speeches by the leaders, they always mention, "Hey, guys, guys, we're entering a slow growth period. We should change from employment culture to entrepreneurship culture." It's there. So MP overcapacity, the term overcapacity, I was so shocked when I went to China, just when the term came out. I thought it was an academic term, but everybody on the street can tell you our country is now suffering from this problem of overcapacity. Where did they get it? From government reports. So I think the people in China, they're very well informed of the obstacles, the backlashes, and the government's interpretation and framing of the challenges. So 100 years of humiliation is continuing. The West is still putting us down as we rise. And that is, you know, that's part of creating consent, but also preparing the people for all kinds of backlashes while still supporting the government and putting the blame on the outside. So that's the most I can say. I don't know whether they underestimate or not, but they're very quick and very skilled in helping people inside China to digest what is happening outside, while at the same time consolidating their hold on society and on public imagination, public knowledge about how to read the world, how to see the world through the lens of the party state.
Yeah, you mentioned this symbolic denomination, this capacity to create narratives. Thank you very much for these answers and the excellent questions. We do have a final question for today from Susan. Susan, I think you're elevated to be able to open your mic, hopefully.
Yeah, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, this is Susan Neiman. I'm the director of the Einstein Forum. And I've been listening with fascination, but also a certain amount of horror to your talk, which was absolutely excellent. So I can speak for the Einstein Forum in saying we would love to have you back next year, particularly to talk about the question of creating consent, because of all the disturbing things you talked about, for me, and I'm a philosopher, so that may play a role, that was the most disturbing of all. I understand that you can't, you know, in the couple of seconds we have left, talk about all of the mechanisms of creating consent, but I just wonder if you could give us a hint at, say, one or two.
Okay, sure. Thank you, Susan. And, you know, I actually wrote a whole paper. I studied for 4 years with a colleague in China, how the regime dissipate protest on the street, like workers blocking the road, asking for money, wages that their employers owe them, or property owners suing or demanding the government to look into violation of their property rights by property developers, peasants, you know, land rights violation, taking away their land. So they went on organized protest, and there were many of them. I mean, as I said, it used to be 900 per year, now it's 600, and these are always underestimations. So I studied how the leaders of these protests, a lot of times when the protests happen, the government would identify first and foremost who were leading that incident. And what they did after identifying them is not to arrest them, because by arresting the leaders, they would create more anger and more activism or more protest by the ordinary rank and file. So one mechanism that we have tracked, and it just applies so universally across all types of protests and all types of leaders, is that the state would bargain with these protest leaders to turn them around with material benefits. As I said, if you have a son that doesn't have a job, looking for a job, they would come in to bargain with you and say, we'll give you a job. They would also try to change the mentality by saying that, well, you think you have legal right to, you know, according to the labor law, you think you have land right according to the land right law, and therefore you can come you can go to the court or come to us to exercise those rights. Guess what? Those officials responsible to calm down and really remove the protests from the street would talk to these protest leaders and say to them, hey, you know what? Yes, you have rights in the law book, but you know, this is China. Who's controlling the court? You know, how would government allow this case to go through the court and give you what you want? This would, you know, you would scare investors away. We can't always present ourselves as pro-labor. So these officials would say to the protest leaders, say, you know, this is China. It's unrealistic for you to expect that your legal right will be realized. So why don't you take what I give you? This is the best you can get in China under our system, and go home. And then, so they would try to reshape, reconfigure people's sense of legal rights. At first they think, well, the government give me labor law and land right law, property right law, so we have rights we can use. And then the lower level grassroots officials would talk to them on a very personal basis. A lot of the consent creation works through personal connection. That's why those great officials, they are on personal, close, intimate terms with those several thousand households that they are responsible for. And they have long-term relationship, and they have so many different kinds of exchanges. But these officials are also agents of the state, in addition to being neighbors to the residents and being relatives or friends to the local residents, citizens. So it is through a whole set of skills and methods, mobilizing social capital, political capital, emotional methods. It's just, I have lots of ethnographic details, but it is not something, the state doesn't present itself as some cold-hearted, heavy-handed, you know, ironclad kind of police coming to crack down. There are so many different faces of the state and so many different levels of state agents. The police, so for instance, this grassroots official talking to the protest leaders, trade a bargaining with them, I give your son a job, you know, you don't have that much right given the realistic circumstances of China, our one party rule. The same official would also, while they bargain with the protest leaders, call in the police to the spot to create fear. So it's a combination of creation of fear, and sometimes they even order the police to arrest the protest leaders so that these officials could show to the protest leaders that they alone can release them, because they can order the police to release them. So they use carrot and stick, they use threat, but they also will, by being personal to them, by saying that, okay, well, the police has arrested you, but I'm your friend, I have ordered them to release you. By arresting but then releasing, the protest leader there is a bond, there is some kind of personal relationship, and there are two faces of the state to sort of convince the protest leaders not to organize the protest anymore. And in the many occasions that I have seen in my research, these protest leaders would turn around to become the informants for the local government and become their foot soldier. So this is just one of the many, many ways in which, you know, it's invisible sort of beneath the radar. You need really take people like me to go inside the process of bargaining, inside the process of encounter between the state and the various level of the various level of the state and citizens, to see how state power works. Is not, most of the time, is not through threat or coercion or violence. No, not within China, not unless you're in Xinjiang or in some minority regions. To the most of the Han majority population, coercion is only used against dissidents. And that is why, or some religious groups like Falun Gong mentioned earlier. If you're an ordinary citizen, Han Chinese in cities, you actually don't see the state in the way you and I, academics outside of China, would see. And this is that popular experience of communist China that I think we still need, we need a good book about. And I think that would be revealing to people to close that gap between perception of the Western perception of China and the local Chinese perception and experience of China.
Professor Lee, wow. And you have been just a remarkable example. I mean, being somebody from Hong Kong, basically have so much insights who help us to understand how Chinese people are from the Sinosphere, so to say, assess the situation on the ground and ongoing trends. Thank you so much also for taking extra time. I think we covered a lot of ground, various questions domestically and internationally. Thank you very much for being with us, for being with the sure. Einstein Forum, and that calls indeed for to be continued, as Susan and Misha already indicated. I also would like, before I hand it back to Misha for a closing statement, so to say, I also would like to thank the audience very, very much for your interest, for your participation, for the excellent questions. And I apologize that we couldn't cover all of them, but I think we covered many of them. There are plenty more of those kind of interesting debates set up by the Einstein Forum. And with that, I would like to hand it over back to Misha for, yeah, some closing words here. Misha, over yes, to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I can, my speaking ability has largely come back. So thanks a lot also for me, CK. I have to say I'm in awe of both the clarity and the complexity of the picture that you painted for us. I mean, this is by far not only the best talk about China, but just hands down one of the best talks at the Einstein Forum that I have ever heard, as evidenced by the many, many questions. I mean, it rarely happens that we take extra time, but still don't have time to take all the audience questions. And Christian, thank you for managing this so elegantly and also adding your own expertise. The only thing left for me to say is to mention that we have one more event before the end of the calendar year. And that will be this Wednesday, someone from California, but this time, luckily, someone who has actually made it to Germany. Deborah Hertz, a professor of history at the University of California, San Diego, will be talking about Berlin Jewish salons in the age of Napoleon. So everybody is very welcome to attend this event, either in person in Potsdam or on Zoom or watch the live stream. And that will be the final event of the calendar year, but not of the season. So everyone is invited to check out our website and look at the rich program of events that we've prepared for you. And with that, I would like to thank Ching Kwan and Christian again, and thank the audience. And I hope to see and hear you all very soon. Goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you so much.